morning, everybody. Today we are very, actually very pleasure. We are very pleased and very honored to invite Professor Frank Maxi coming to Taiwan for giving us the keynote speech and also join some activities the afternoon models. I think that now is the time that our society and our nation start to hear the SIF process. We know that actually in our environmental impact assessment and regulation, we have to conduct this important component of the SIF. But earlier, this is very hard to be conducted. So our new government and the new EPA are now trying to complete this work. So they actually assigned our center, with the Society of Policy Research Center, since the end of this year, start to work out about the SIF regulation. And some of the colleagues already joined our up hearing the SIF draft and also gave us many important opinion and suggestion. So today, actually, Professor Frank Maxi, I think that he is also the first time in Taipei. Yeah. So I think that he will give us some comparative version in Taiwan or in Netherlands. So let me shortly introduce Professor Maxi. Professor Maxi is now a professor of cultural geography in the Faculty of Spatial Science at the University of Groningen, Netherlands. And actually, Professor Winters is has long, for a long time associated with IAIA, the International Social Impact Assessment Association, for over 25 years. And he also holds many leadership positions. He's actually the former director of the IAIA, and he's the current chair of the editorial board of the IAIA Journal Impact Assessment and the Project Appraisal. So he will today give up 1 hour keynote speech, and then we will open to the floor. And I think most of our colleagues from academic and also from civil groups might raise some questions to him and to exchange our opinion by each other. So that I also have to express my gratitude to the Professor He Min Xiu and Dr. Wang Dianjie, who actually spent much time for translating this new version of the IAIA guidelines published in 2015. And so this is a very update and the very newest guideline of IAIA now. So we are very welcome to all our colleagues trying to think to take this book. This is the publishing from our center. Okay. So we will have the translation. Okay. So now the Professor Linkes will give some part of the speech to will be translated by the colleague here. Okay. So let us give a big hand to welcome Professor Linkes.
So my role is to give an introduction to social impact assessment to explain how it's developed it and what it is like now, and to discuss some of the new concepts that are happening in the field of social impact assessment. The first thing I need to say is that there's three competing discourses. So just to make sure that when you're Googling and you're looking for literature on social impact assessment, or you're looking for online videos, be aware that there's three different discourses. One discourse relates to the European Commission, the European Union, and it's about how they assess the impact of European Commission policies, particularly in relation to the social policy goals the European Union has. So it's very much a European Union discourse. There's also a discourse of philanthropy that's relatively new, the last 10 years or so, and it's about how we might analyse the social consequences of the investment decisions of philanthropic organisations, or even when there's a commercial company with a social investment fund, what's the added value of the funding that they provide to a community? And the last discourse is my discourse, which has been around for about 50 years now, and it's the social version of environmental impact assessment.
大家早安，今天我的角色就是要来介绍一下社会影响评估在过去的发展、现在的现况以及未来可能会有一些新的概念。那么首先我想要介绍一下社会影响评估在现在主要有三个主要的看法，所以大家在上线然后找一些文本或者是影片的时候，就要注意它其实背后是有三个不同的脉络。第一个是在欧盟的圈圈当中，他们主要是用社会影响评估来评估他们的政策。第二个则是在比较人道或者是慈善的圈圈当中，他们在过去十年内才开始注重到社会影响评估，那他们会用这个社会影响评估来分析他们不论是在慈善上或者是企业他们在投资上的时候可能会带来什么样的利益。那最后则是我个人的看法，或者是我们这一个学派的看法。那这一个派看法就是在社会影响评估圈或者是产业圈当中过去五十年来的看法。那我们就等于是环境影响评估，可是把它改成社会版本。
So in this last discourse, we see that social impact assessment is a well-established international concept. It started in the USA in the 1970s. It's required by law in many countries. It's required by many international organizations. It's standard operating practice for many industry organizations, many companies. There's a strong professional community. There's a professional association, conferences, journals, a body of literature. In fact, we call it a paradigm. There's a community of scholars and a body of practice. It's well established.
那么在我刚提到的最后一个看法当中，其实这是一个已经建立了非常完善的一个学派。它最早是在1970年代的时候由美国开始发起，那现在它已经是受到很多立法的保护，有很多的国际的机构或是公司他们都会要求这一个做法。那它现在也有很强健的一个社群，像是它有一些职业的协会，有会议，有期刊，还有很多的文本，所以现在它已经可以被称之为是一个典范了。
So social impact assessment can be used in many ways. The discussion here in Taiwan is about the regulatory model of social impact assessment. That's useful, but there are other ways in which social impact assessment can be used. It can be used by companies to manage their social risks. It can be used by communities to understand the impact.Of projects on them. It can be used by NGOs acting on behalf of communities. It can be used by funding bodies, the banks, especially the equator principles banks, which I'll explain later. And it can be used by government regulatory agencies.
那 SIA 其实有很多的不同的用途。那我知道在台湾现在主要是为了要拿来评估你们 的立法跟法规，可是其实在公司方面他们也会用 SIA 来评估一些社会风险，在社群方面他们也是一样会评估不同的开发计划对他们的影响，那对于非政府组织而言他们也会代表不同的社群来评估，那最后当然还有像是一些金融机构尤其是跟赤道原则有关的机构，这个他稍后还会再提到，那最后当然就是像台湾所说的跟政府法规有关。
So what this means is that there's not just one type of SIA and one way of thinking about social impact assessment, there's many different ways of doing that.
也就是说我们在做社会影响评估的时候不是只有一个做法，它是有很多不同的做法，很多不同的思维。
So the current understanding of social impact assessment has evolved over time. Initially, social impact assessmentTried to be as much like environmental impact assessment as it could be. Over time, it was realized that actually social issues are different, and social impact assessment therefore needed to be different as well, also to be useful for all those different purposes. There's two key documents, one from 2003, the International Principles for Social Impact Assessment,and then again in 2015, the guidance document, which is now being translated into Taiwanese.
好，所以其实 SIA 在过去是不同的不停的在演化。最早的时候，大家觉得说 SIA 大概跟 EIA 就是跟环境影响评估是一样的就可以了。但随着时间的演进，大家才发现，其实社会议题跟环境议题不同，所以它会带来的影响也不同，我们要做的方法也就会不同。那目前是有两个比较主要的条文，一个是2003年的 SIA 原则，那另外一个则是2015年出版的，刚刚也有提到有被翻译成中文的这一个指导原则。
So this process of codifying what social impact assessment has been like has been a slightly difficult process, and that difficulty is reflected in the definition of social impact assessment. So this is the definition of social impact assessment. It goes that SIA includes means not limited to, the processes in the plural of analyzing, monitoring and managing three things, the intended and unintended social consequences, both positive and negative, of planned interventions, which means policies, programs, plans and projects, and any social consequences invoked by those interventions. That's a definition designed by our committee to solve every argument that has been had about what social impact assessment is about.
所以在条文化的过程当中其实非常非常的困难，那其中一个很大的原因是因为我们在定义社会影响评估的时候就遇到很大的困难。在目前的定义上，我们是把它定义成它包括，可是这个包括是不仅限于，包括了什么呢？就是在分析、监测还有管理这些过程。那这些过程可以看到英文又是用复数的，那是什么样的过程呢？它是提到不论是你有意的还是无意的造成的一些社会影响，那这个社会影响可以是正面也可以是负面，那是什么东西造成的负面影响呢？是经过计划的一些摄入，所以指的就是像政策计划或者一些开发计划，那这一些东西带来的社会影响或者是他们间接带来的其他的影响也都要被纳入考量当中。所以可以看到这个定义当初是一个委员会他们想出来的，就是希望可以透过这个定义去解决社会风险评估的所有议题。
So much too complicated, even I can't remember it and I wrote it.
所以真的非常复杂，连我自己写的我自己都有点不太记得。
So much easier just to say that social impact assessment is the process of managing the social issues associated with projects.
所以比较简单一点的定义，我们其实大可以说 SIA 它就是在管理因为开发计划所带来的社会影响。
And then for people who are familiar with environmental impact assessment, I say it's just like environmental impact assessment, except that it deals with the social issues.
那对于比较了解环境影响评估的人来说，我也是想要说 SIA 跟环境影响评估其实是很像的啦，只是它主要是在探讨或者是在规范社会影响的部分。
The problem is that social impacts are different than environmental impacts. They're different in many ways. First of all, they're different in that environmental impacts can only start happening when the project starts. We say when the first sort of soil is turned. Social impacts happen the moment there's a rumor about a project.
那话虽如此，环境影响评估跟社会影响评估还是不同。那主要的不同有几点呢？第一点就是我们在讨论社会环境影响评估的时候，环境影响其实是从这个开发计划真的动土之后才会开始影响，但社会影响并不是这样，我们还在讨论，有一些谣言在传说可能要开始动工的时候就已经会带来社会影响了。
And the problem too is that misinformation is spread and people respond to misinformation. So it's a great cartoon because it is true that misinformation travels faster than the real facts.
好，但问题就是在于说，错误的资讯其实散布的是非常非常快。这里可以看到一个漫画，里面的角色就有提到说，诶，资讯传得很快，可是错误的资讯传得更快，因为他就提到，诶，真正的事实很少被人家拿出来讲，可是错误的东西却是一再再而三的被大家提出来。
And so, a developer, a proponent, actually has to manage how information travels in a community, and the developer has to manage what misinformation happens. Misinformation has the potential to create harm in the community, so an awareness of the misinformation is important.
所以对于开发商来说，他们就真的要去好好的管理资讯的传播，那也要去管理这个资讯是怎么样被传到不同的社群里。那很多时候还会有一些错误的资讯，那错误的资讯可能就会带来一些伤害或者是负面的影响，所以他们真的要让社群去了解到不同的计划它背后的影响是什么。
When projects happen and information and misinformation spread, people respond, and they respond in all sorts of ways. Immediately, people might change their opinion about what the location is like. And this can result in economic consequences. For example, real estate prices may go up or down depending on whether it presents a speculative opportunity or not. And also people's place attachment might be affected by this. Also, people might flock into the area in search of business opportunities or compensation opportunities. In fact, that's called the honeypot effect. So the critical question is, in any project, even before the project starts, we can have an influx of people, or we can have a stigmatization of the place, a denigration of the quality of the place.
所以在计划开始动土之前，就已经会有很多的资讯跟错误资讯，那就会导致人们会有各种不同的反应。那么其中一种反应可能就是他们会对这一个计划要动土的地点产生一些不同的想法。举例来说，就经济上来讲好了，可能会导致这个地方的地价或者是房价上涨或者是下跌。那么大家对于这个地方的情感会有不同的见解。可能会有些人因为这个可能开发的计划而涌入这个地方，因为他们可能觉得说之后可能这边会有更多的商业机会，或者是可以炒地皮，或者他们想要接受赔偿。那这就是所谓的蜜罐效应。所以早在一个计划真的开始之前，就已经可能会有很多的居民或者很多的人涌入这个地区，也有可能会导致这个地方它有一些污名化，也是有可能的。
So in developing countries,the honeypot effect can lead to this influx of people looking for opportunities. And the impact of the influx of people can be many times more serious than the impacts from the actual project.
所以尤其是在开发中国家，常常在讲一个地方可能会有开发的计划案的时候，就会有大量的人涌入那个地区。那这个涌进来的人潮，它会带来的影响，其实是比这个计划它本身真的会带来的实质影响，是它来的更大的。
So another way which environmental impacts differ from social impacts is that environmental impacts tend to be only negative. many negative, and environmental impacts tend to be much more predictable and stable. Right? Sometimes experts might disagree, but inherently, once it is understood what it is, they are relatively stable. Social impacts are very different. They can be positive as well as negative. They can affect people differently. What's good for one person can be bad for another person. And people's perception about the impact might also change over time. So the impacts are not stable.
另外一个社会影响评估跟环境影响评估不同的地方在于，环境影响通常是比较多都是负面的，而且它是比较不稳定的，所以可能说在讨论的时候，有一些专家的看法会不同，但一旦有了共识之后，大家都知道好，它的影响大概是这样，大家可以预测。但是社会影响就比较不一定，它可以是好的，也可以是不好的。有一些影响可能对这一群人来说是好的影响，但对另外一群人来说却是不好的影响。另外一点就是它会随着时间而改变，它不是那么稳定。
So when we study social impacts of projects generally, one of the things that we find is one of the major recurring impacts is fear and anxiety.
所以我们在看到很多不同的计划带来的社会影响，在研究的时候就发现它常常带来的就是恐惧跟焦虑。
Now sometimes fear and anxiety are well-founded and based on reasonable assessment of risks, and other times fear and anxiety comes from the misinformation that's been distributed.
所以有时候确实没有错，这一些恐惧跟焦虑是源自真的，他们评估过的合理的风险，可是有很多时候它是来自错误的讯息的散布。
Now, fear and anxiety are real social impacts that do affect people. So a project needs to manage how fear and anxiety are created.
那这一些恐惧跟焦虑确实也是社会影响，因为它真的就是影响某些人。所以在开发计划的时候，我们也是要把这一种情况纳入考量。
An important principle in social impact assessment is perception is reality. What that means is, actually from a personal perspective, if people perceive something or believe something to be the case, they are affected by whether it is fact or true or not. It is because of their perception that they have fear and anxiety. It's because of their perception that they become angry. It's because of their perception that they change their views about things and experience social impacts. So one of the tricky things for social impact assessment is we have to manage expectations, we have to manage fear and anxiety, and we have to accept that these are real impacts.
那其中一个重点我们要认知到的就是民众的观感很多时候就等于事实，因为不管今天事实是什么，如果大家他们人们觉得这件事情就是这样，他们认为这件事情就是这样，那他们就会这样子的被影响。所以他们觉得这件事情这样，他们可能就会因此而愤怒，他们会因此而恐惧，他们会因此而改变他们对一些发展的看法。所以这在实际的操作面上，它就是带来了社会影响。所以我们在评估的时候就要很小心，我们要怎么样去管理大家对于一个计划的预期，还有他们的恐惧，然后这样子才可以真的去把所有的社会影响都纳入考量当中。
The photo, by the way, is a row of windmills turbines on the top of the mountain range. And the reason why I've chosen this photo is your judgment that your aesthetic appreciation of the landscape affected by the wind turbines or not? That's your question of perception.
好，所以我选这张图是因为大家可能可以后面可能看不太清楚，但它在这个山上面是放了一排的风力发电机。那这一个风力发电机的设置会不会对于这个风景造成影响呢？你觉得它会带来负面的影响吗？那这个就是个人观感的问题。
So the first set was how social impacts differ from environmental impacts in their nature and character. The second point of difference is to really be hinted at.That people react to the impacts.
所以刚刚我们讲到社会评估跟 社会评估跟环境评估本质上的不同。那第二点，另外的不同，则是刚刚也有提到的民众的反应。
People react in all sorts of ways, primarily by protesting. In fact, with one of my PhD students, we've written a paper where we have identified 200 different ways in which people can protest.
所以民众的反应当然很多时候就是他们会抗议。那我跟我的一位博士学生就有一起写了一个论文，里面就整理出了200多种不同的抗议方式。
And protest means that social impacts are not just something that's external to the project that the project can ignore. Protest means that there are very real impacts to the project in how they might be affected. They can be affected in many ways, and I can read them out.
好，所以有抗议的话，就表示说这些社会影响对于计划案来说，不是只是一个外在的因素，他们没有办法就直接视而不见，把它忽略掉。它是会带来实质的影响的。那这些影响呢，就是在这个页面上，它可能包括会有一些实际上的伤害，可能会让你产值降低，可能会让你丢掉你的合法的一些法律上的一些授权或者是你的执照，可能会被带去法院，然后被告上法庭。有时候可能会被罚款，有时候可能还会失去你的名声，可能你的股价会下跌，你可能会以后没有办法去新的地方开发，等等等等。
So another way in which people react to social impacts and makes process being particularly important.
也就是说，因为大家会抗议，所以呢，过程真的最重要。
So this is a story. Actually, this photo could be anywhere. This happens to be Groningen, where I'm from. But I want you to imagine, I'm going to tell you a little story. I want you to imagine somewhere that's familiar to you. If you woke up in the morning and the street was dug up and you were inconvenienced, you couldn't get your car out, your daily activities, your daily routine was affected, you would feel angry.You would feel upset.
好，那这边这一张照片是在格罗宁根拍摄的，但其实大家可以想象看看，不管今天这个地点在哪里，我们试想一下，如果今天这件事情发生在我们熟悉的地方，发生在我们的生活当中，你一早醒来就发现下面的街道被挖掉了，然后导致你的不便，你可能日常生活中要做的事情都被影响，你可能就会生气，你会不高兴。
Now, what happens if maybe a month beforehand?The authorities had written to you to say, we have to dig up your street, we're very sorry. We need to do this in order to give you the super fast internet cable, the fiber optic cable to your house, or to replace the gas pipeline so you can have a gas in your house, or to give you a clean water pipe into your house. And we will do this in 1 month's time. If you contact us, if it's not convenient, maybe we can come to an arrangement.Right? When you wake up in the morning, even if you've forgotten to move the car, you say, "You beauty, I'm getting my new internet."
好，那我们今天再想象一下另外一个情况。如果在他们动工之前的一个月，他们就先通知你说，哎，一个月之后我们会要动工，那真的很不好意思带来不便。可是我们要动工的原因，可能是因为我们要帮你装光纤，让你以后上网可以变得更快，或者是给你新的天然气的管线，或者是帮你。更换你原本旧的自来水的管线，那这样子一来，如果你那天早上醒来，你就算是前一天忘记把你的车子移走了，你还是会记得这件事情，然后很高兴，想说，哎，太好了，我以后上网速度会变快。
So whether this is a social impact as a negative or not, has all to do with process. A good process means no impact, no negative impact. A bad process means lots of impacts.
所以讲到社会。影响的评估，其实重点真的就是在你这个过程是怎么处理的。如果你处理的好，它就不会带来任何负面的效应。那如果处理不好，当然就是会有负面效应。
So we need to encourage projects to have a much more social awareness and a much more people-friendly way in which they interact with their stakeholders.
所以我们必须要鼓励不同的开发商或者不同的开发计划，他们。一定要懂得这一点，他们要多跟民众沟通，然后呢，也要 对民众更加的友善。
There's lots more that can be done too. You can see here, this is a pizzeria. So this pizzeria is economically affected because their business will, if this is the entrance to the pizzeria, their business is going to be affected, right? So are they entitled to compensation?
那图片里面大家可以看到左手边有一家披萨店，那这个披萨店会因为这一个开发计划或者这个道路的动工而在他们的经济上会受到影响，可能他们主要的出入口被挡住了，所以在这个情况之下，他们是不是可以获得一些补偿呢？
Now, whether they're entitled to compensation or not is a complex question. It depends on the law in the country where this is being discussed. It also depends on different understandings about what's right or what's not right. Rather than discuss what the law is, it's much better to think how could the developer manage this better. So it's quite possible that there are any number of opportunities here. With some planning, the pizzeria could have been notified in advance and they could have decided to have holidays. Instead of being open and not having any business, they could have gone on holidays for the time. Potentially, they could be compensated for the lost revenue that they might experience. Alternatively, the developer might say, all of our workers will go and have lunch there every day.
所以这一个披萨店要不要被补偿，当然背后是一个很复杂的议题，取决于当地的法律，还有大家对于什么是对的，什么是不对的一些看法。但是重点是，对于开发商而言，他就要好好的去管理这个情况。所以，如果他们事先就知道在这边动土的话，他可能就可以先跟这个披萨店讲说：“哎，我们这要动土，说不定你们可以去在这个期间去放个假，啊，这样子你们就不会空在那边开了店，可是却等不到客人。”那或者是我们也可以说：“哎，可能我们在动工的这段期间，你们的营收会被影响，所以呢，我们就会叫我们的工人每天午餐都去吃你们的披萨，作为这一种补偿，其实也是可以。”
So it means also that actually there are many solutions possible and there can be creativity in the way we think about solutions. And in order to reduce the social impacts from projects, we need to be cleverer about the way we do projects.
所以解决方案有时候是需要透过一些创意才可以想出来的。那我们要降低社会影响的话，就是想要我们必须要能够想出一些更聪明的做法。
Social impact assessment is sometimes interpreted as being an objective assessment of the social impacts. But that's rather difficult because people's view about the project varies at different points in time. And people's view about the project varies in relation to how much they know about the project and how much they thought about the project. In some situations, it could be possible that people have never thought about the project. So when the social impact assessment person comes along and asks the affected community what they think about the project, they might say something like, well, we've never thought about it. We weren't worried, but now that you're asking us a question, maybe we should be.
那很多人可能会觉得社会影响评估是一个非常客观的事情，可是刚刚你有提到大家对于社会影响的看法是会随着时间改变，会随着他们的知识背景而改变，也会随着他们有没有去仔细思考而改变。所以很多时候其实在我们做社会评估之前，当地的居民是没有去想过相关的议题的，甚至有时候我们派人去问他们问题的时候，他们的回答是我真的从来没想过哎，那现在既然你问了，我觉得我好像应该要开始担心一下。
Actually, sometimes people's dissatisfaction with impact assessment has been considerable. This is a picture relating to a story where, in Brazil, the three people doing the environmental, these are ecologists, they were doing the biodiversity assessment for a dam, for environmental impact assessment for a dam.And the local community felt that their views had never been listened to, they did not want the dam to happen, and they thought that the environmental impact assessment was just legitimation of the dam. They did not believe that there was any real discussion about why the project. So they captured these three ecologists And they held them prisoner for 3 months.
好，所以在社会影响评估的时候，有时候就是会带来一些负面的影响。举例来说，在这个照片里面是一个发生在巴西的例子。当时有三个生态学家，他们要去研究一个地方它的生态多样性，因为政府当时是决定要在那个地方新建一个水坝。那他们在那边调查的时候，当地的人们就开始觉得说他们的意见没有被聆听，他们觉得好像政府在做这些评估其实是为了后续发展的合理化，所以最后当地居民就把这三个生态学家抓起来，然后还囚禁他们长达三个月的时间。
So this is part of the story that says projects need to be legitimate, acceptable to the community, but the impact assessment process itself has to be acceptable and legitimate to the community.
所以这个故事就告诉我们，开发案计划确实要能够被当地的居民接受，可是我们在做影响评估的时候，这个影响评估本身也要能够被当地的居民接受。
So,Ultimately, the whole process of managing the social issues, it's not just about identifying the impacts in a report like a social version of environmental impact statement. It's about effectively managing the relationships between the project and the affected community.
所以我们在做社会影响评估的时候，我们不是只是很客观的去指出它会造成什么影响，我们是要去真的可以管理这个计划跟当地的居民他之间的关系。
So what this means is for business and for projects and for governments maybe even, it's a new age. There's social risks, not only technical risks that they need to manage.
所以说，这对于企业、政府或者是开发商来说，表示这是一个全新的时代。我们要管理的。不是只有技术上的风险，还有很多社会上的风险。
So the next point of difference is the way in which regulation happens. The traditional model is to presume that a government agency was the only regulator, but actually nowadays regulators are much more diffuse and diverse.
那么第三个不同的地方则是在于法规面。传统上大家可能会觉得政府是唯一一个可以订定法规的团体，可是其实现在真的可以去影响到法规的人呢是更多样而且更分散。
So firstly, many companies have policy papers, position papers. They have their own internal standards that are quite reasonable.And meet international expectations. And the big companies, the big international companies, they enforce their standards at each project site.
所以举例来说，现在很多大型的跨国或者是国际企业，他们都会有内部的准则。这些准则或者是标准都是合乎国际规范的。所以他们在进行开发案的时候，都会确保这些开发案也有合乎他们的标准。
At the industry level, many international industry organizations, the umbrella bodies, they have standards for their industry.
那么在产业面来说，有一些比较大的产业的协会，他们也是有他们的标准。
You can some of the main ones. This is the oil and gas industry social and environmental organization. This is the mining industry sectionals. This is a sustainable palm oil production.There's all sorts of, actually this should have been on the previous slide, there's all sorts of international industry standards that apply.
所以在这个页面上大家可以看到像是 IPIECA, 他们就是在管理石油跟天然气， ICMM 则是管理矿产，那另外还有 RSPO, 他们是管理永续发展的棕榈油。那么刚刚他也有提到，其实这一页上面那个 Newmont 是放错，应该要放在前面一页，但重点还是一样，这个页面上可以看到很多产业的不同的协会也是在进行规范。
So what are the main standard setters, and perhaps the most important part of the review of projects is the finance industry. So the international finance organizations, these are the big banks that lend big money to big projects. They all have social and environmental performance standards.And they all, before they lend money to projects, they ensure that those projects have social and environmental management systems in place. each bank has its own procedures and policies, but over time there's been convergence and harmonisation. So it's reasonable to say that even though they're slightly different, we can presume that there's an international understanding. It's usually from the IFC.
好，所以讲到在规范的时候，还有一个很重要的角色，就是金融机构，就是那些国际的大银行，因为他们才可以提供资金给开发商去进行他们的开发案。所以这一些国际银行跟他们的组织，其实也都有他们自己的社会还有环境影响的标准，他们会确保说这个开发商他们在开始一个开发计划之前有完善的管理的准则或者是管理的措施。所以虽然不同的银行或者是组织他们可能有自己不同的标准或者是做法，但随着时间的演进，我们可以看到的是他们的标准有越来越统一化。所以虽然可能有些细微的不同，但是整体上来说，我们可以看得到业界产业界他们对于这一些标准有了大致的共识。那等一下他还会再提到 ISC。
It's worth mentioning that the two new banks,They are also in this group. They also have environmental and social performance standards, which are pretty much the same as the other banks.
那值得一提的是，像 IAAB 跟 MDB 这两个银行，他们都是比较新的银行或者是组织，可是他们也跟其他的银行一样，都有这一方面的措施跟标准。
So the World Bank, it's the big bank that lends money to governments.The IFC is the private sector lending arm of the World Bank, and it lends money to private sector projects. So the original social safeguards, and safeguards were from the World Bank, the IFC has its performance standards. The IFC's performance standards have become particularly important because they've been adopted by the Equator Principles, which is the environmental and social performance for the whole financial industry.
所以这边可以看到世界银行它当然就是一个专门借钱给各国政府的一个金融机构，另外还有刚刚提到 IFC 它则是私部门版本的世界银行，它是专门借钱给开发商给他们进行计划案。所以这一些组织他们就要把关不同的社会风险管理方面的标准。那我们也可以看到它之所以很重要，是因为现在 IFC 他们的标准已经被纳入了所谓的赤道原则当中。那赤道原则就是专门在管理这些金融机构他们在借钱或者是融资给不同的计划案的时候必须要达到的一些标准。
So most of the world's big banks have signed up to the Equator Principles. It represents more than 80 banks now, and it represents more than 70% of project financing in developing countries.
所以现在赤道计划已经规模相当的庞大，我们可以看到有超过80家的银行他们都签署或者都加入了这个原则。那现在在开发中国家当中的所有开发案当中，也有70%以上都是受到赤道原则的规范。
So the real leverage for social impact assessment is if a project is borrowing money from an Equator Principles bank, it must meet the international performance standards of the IFC that have been adopted by the Equator Principles.
也就是说，一个开发商他们要真的动土之前，他们当然需要资金。那他们在借钱之前，尤其是如果要跟这个签署了赤道原则的金融机构借钱之前，他们就一定要能够确保自己内部是有经过这些社会影响的标准。
There are other initiatives. The United Nations has developed again with industry the principles for responsible investment.But basically, they have a very similar approach to IFC's performance standards at Equator Principles.
那么另外像联合国，他们也是一样跟业界一起合作，然后发展出了所谓的责任投资原则。那责任投资原则其实就是跟刚刚提到的 IFC 还有赤道原则一样，都是在规范社会影响。
In fact, the same story has been repeated with the insurance industry. Even if a project did not need to borrow money.He would still need to have insurance, and the world's insurance industry has basically had the same standards. To get insurance, you need to comply with proper risk assessment, which now includes an assessment of your social and environmental risks, and you need to manage them effectively.
那么，同样的情况在 保险业也可以看到，有一些开发计划，他们或许不需要借钱，但他们还是必须要保险。那他们能够保险之前呢，现在保险业有所谓的 PSI 永续保险原则，那它其实就跟刚刚讲到的世道原则也是一模一样，它会确保它在帮一家开发商或开发计划保险之前，他们是有通过了社会风险管理的一些评估，然后他们可以真的有效的去管理社会风险跟环境风险。
And then if companies misbehave, there's any number of NGOs, ENGOs, INGOs, or watchdog organizations that will make sure you do the right. Watchdog, it's a word that's applied to an NGO that's particularly activist and will take action. Right? So you can see anything that has watch, Amazon Watch, Human Rights Watch, you know, anything that has watch in its name, there's many of them. These are activist organizations who see their job to monitor what happens in the commercial world and to take action on behalf of communities when there's a problem.
那么如果这些开发商或者是公司他们表现不佳，或者是他们没有真的乖乖的合作，也有很多的机构，像是这一些非政府组织的机构，他们会采取行动去惩罚这些企业。所以这些非政府组织呢，英文都把它合成叫做 watchdog。所以在他们的组织名字里面，如果有看到出现 watch 看守或者是把关这样子的字眼的话，我们就知道这些组织他会去评估这一个公司有没有乖乖的合乎规范。如果没有的话，他们就会代表社群去惩罚这一些企业。
In fact, even the ordinary people can take action as a result of projects, and they can be successful. So this is an 85-year-old woman. She's protesting against a road development, actually, that's going to take away her house. It's an expansion of a road. She's lived in her house all her life. She doesn't want to move now. So she's started a campaign to stop the widening of the road, and she's been successful.
那么就算是一般人，我们也是可以采取行动，而且也是可以成功的。像是照片这里面看到的，就是一位85岁的老奶奶，她就是在抗议一个道路拓宽的计划，因为道路拓宽之后会害她家必须要被拆掉。可是她因为住在这个房子里面已经一辈子了，她不想要搬走，所以她就进行了这一系列的抗议活动，最后她还真的成功。
Now you might call this a reactive protest.She's personally affected, and therefore she's reacting. But there's also proactive protest. So this is a protest by students. Actually, it's happened in many places, particularly at American universities. You can see I've put some there. And they're advocating against the boards of their universities about how their universities invest the money the universities have. And basically, they're saying that it's not conscionable for university funds to be invested in carbon-destroying projects. So they're advocating that there must be divestment of bad projects.
那么刚刚这个85岁老奶奶的案例是一个比较反应性的抗议，但也就是说她受到影响了，所以她去抗议。但是也有一些比较主动的抗议，像是在这边我们可以看到，尤其是在美国的大学校园里，有越来越多的学生，他们在开始一些自发性的、主动性的抗议。那这边图片里面，他们就在抗议他们学校的董事会把学校的资金拿去投资在一些可能会破坏环境的计划当中。像他们就是说，这样子做实在是非常没有良心，大学的资金不应该拿去投资在会破坏我们地球、破坏我们环境的计划当中，必须要停止这一方面的投资。
So this type of protest represents reputational harm for the organizations that they're protesting against.
所以这一类型的抗议当然就是会对于这些组织带来他们的名声上面的损坏。
So another example of this is a story about this report. This is a report, it's a human rights assessment, and basically there's a convergence between human rights assessments and social assessment. This is a human rights assessment of a mine in Guatemala. It was bought by a Canadian company. Canadian company, it's a big multinational. One of the big shareholders in that Canadian mining company was the Swedish National Pension Fund. And the Swedish National Pension Fund, like good Europeans, they don't want their money creating harm. So they said to this Canadian company, we've heard that there are human rights abuses at this mine. We want you to fix it up. Do a human rights impact assessment and do a report. And if you don't fix it up, we will disinvest. Right? So the threat was that they had to do something about it. So the Swedish National Pension Funds made this company change the way it did business.
那么另外我们也可以看到像这个案例当中它是一个人权的影响评估，那我们现在在业界当中看到的情况也是人权的影响评估跟社会影响评估是有越来越融合或者是结合的一个情况。那在这个案例当中看到的是一个在瓜地马拉的矿坑或者是矿场，有一家加拿大的国际挖矿的公司，他们是在这一个矿场进行挖矿。那在这一个公司的背后，其中一个资金来源是瑞典他们的国家退休金的基金。那瑞典人欧洲人嘛，他们就是比较在乎他们的钱会去投资哪里，所以当他们发现说这个矿场可能有一些人权上面的违规的时候，他们就警告这个加拿大的公司说，我希望你们去做一个人权影响调查，如果发现有任何的不符合标准的地方，你们要必须马上修正，否则我们就马上把我们投资的钱全部都退出来。
So we call this the concept of ethical investment. It's a growing idea. It's a philosophy that's been developing and will become an increasingly important part of the whole investment world into the future.
所以这个做法我们就称之为道德投资。那这个做法现在在业界也越来越被重视，以后会越来越重要。
So basically, to sum up where I'm at now, I've said that social impact assessment is similar but different to environmental impact assessments. It's different in the sense of the way that the social impacts are experienced and happen. It's different in the sense that people react, and as a result of their reaction, they protest. So therefore, in order to deal with, environmental impact assessment does not exist just to approve a project. The idea of environmental impact assessment was to ensure that projects were done better. In social impact assessment, we want projects to be done better,But in order to do that, we have to manage the social issues all the way through the project cycle.
所以总结一下我目前提到的几个重点，第一当然就是社会影响评估跟环境影响评估有很多的相似之处，可是他们也有很多根本上的不同。相似之处就是他们都是在评估影响，但是不同的地方就是在于说社会影响它背后牵扯的因素比较多，像是刚刚提到民众会有不同的反应。所以呢，我们要记得的是，我们在做环境影响评估的时候，它的目的不是只是为了让一个计划案可以被实现，而是要让它可以被做得更好。那我们在做社会影响评估的时候也是一样，不只是要让这个计划可以做得更好，我们要可以去真的管理它对于社会带来的影响，还有对于社会议题带来的影响。
So to manage the social impacts throughout the project cycle, the way of thinking about social impacts has to be incorporated in the project in terms of social and environmental management systems.
所以要真的可以改变这个计划案的话，我们这个社会影响的思维要能够真的被融入在这个计划案它的整个周期当中。
So if we look at a typical project cycle, here's closure of the project, and here's when the first starting of thinking about the project. It goes through several planning phases, a first phase called conceptual, a second phase called pre-feasibility, then feasibility, then construction, operations, and closure. What tends to happen is that formal project approval only happens between feasibility and construction.
所以在这边我们可以看到一个典型的计划，它会经历的周期当中有很多不同的步骤或者是阶段。最一开始它会有一些比较跟概念或者是思考或者是计划有关，那最后则是结束。所以中间可以经过很多像是概念上面的发想，或者是可行性评估之前，还有可行性评估跟计划，然后才是真正的 去营造，然后最后开始营运，然后最后结束。那我们常常看到的就是一个计划它要被真的许可的话，这个阶段是发生在可行性评估跟真的实际动土中间。
So we do need the regulator to consider whether project approval should be given here, but more important, we need management of the social issues at all phases, from the time rumors happen, through misinformation, through how the project is conceived. In fact, so many missed opportunities exist because the project can be designed better to improve the benefits of the project as well as to reduce the harm if thinking about the social issues happens here. If we wait to hear, it's too late.
所以刚刚提到，很多时候我们真的去许可或是拒绝一个计划案，是发生在可行性计划之后。可是要是我们在这个阶段当中这个过程当中的每一个阶段都融入社会影响评估的话，那其实我们就可以真的管理它带来的社会影响。在过去我们看到有很多很好的机会最后被错失掉，就是因为他们在设计或是发想的过程当中没有真的纳入社会影响的考量。所以如果我们真的可以把社会影响评估放在每一个阶段当中的话，我们就可以发想出更好的开发计划，然后带来更好的机会。
So what this means is social impact assessment does many things. It does do the ex ante assessment of impacts that you might have expected from environmental impact assessment, but it also does much more than that. The social impact assessment people have to liaise with the EIA teamTo make sure that the social aspects of environmental impacts are considered, they have to develop a community profile. They've got to construct a social baseline. They've got to implement the changes into the project. They've got to plan the resettlement process. They've got to develop the resettlement policy framework and the resettlement action plan.
所以，我们可以看到社会影响评估它带来的影响，或是它要负责的事情，真的非常非常的多。首先，当然就是我们都知道的，它必须要在事前去评估一个计划它可能会带来的社会影响有哪些。但除此之外，他们也可以负责去跟环境影响评估的团队一起沟通，来确保说，这个环境影响它带来的社会影响又有哪些？社会影响带来的环境影响又有哪些？另外，他们可以更加的去了解当地的社群，然后去对于决定的过程当中，他们可以收集一些重要的数据或者是重要的资料。那另外，他们也可以去确保说，这个计划在实施的时候可能会带来什么样子的影响。然后，如果带来影响的话，他们要怎么样去补偿，或者是如果有需要去进行一些变更，或者要把一些人移走的话，他们背后的实际作为要怎么做，他们都可以去评估。
They have to do a human rights due diligence.They have to think about enhancing the benefits of projects. They have to identify the stakeholders, map the interests, and work out how to engage with stakeholders. They have to consider if Indigenous peoples are present and how to implement free, prior, and informed consent. They have to assist affected communities in understanding what the project's likely to be like. And they have to think about how local content, local procurement, can be enhanced. And they have to monitor the social issues.
那么另外他们也可以去观测人权有没有被影响，然后他们也要去看看这个计划它带来的好处要真的去指认出来有哪一些。另外他们也要去看看所有的关系人他们背后带来的利益和他们的关系还有可能潜在的一些发展有哪一些。另外他们也要真的确保当地的社群他们在许可这个计划之前是真的自主事前有被告知，而且是真的认同的。另外，他们要看看这个计划会不会影响到所谓的原住民，或是当地的原本的原住民。然后，如果有的话，又要怎么样可以去减轻对他们的影响？那么，最后他们也要去看看这个计划能不能融入一些当地的元素，像是把当地的生产或者是服务纳入到他们的整个产业链当中。
They have to design and implement social investment actions that the project might do. They have to think about appropriate compensation. They have to design and implement grievance mechanisms. Potentially, they might negotiate an impacts and benefits agreement with the local community. This is like a contract with the local community. They have to develop social impact management plans. They have to prepare the documentation for the regulatory agency. They have to identify the issues and obligations for dealing with subcontractors. Actually, big projects have many subcontractors. From a community point of view, many of the impacts actually come from the subcontractor. So the primary developer has to manage the subcontractors in relation to the project impacts. They need to prepare statements for the funding agency. They might have to do a due diligence for ensuring social performance for a community, for an NGO. And they have to think about closure planning. When projects close, closure planning has to happen early.
此外，他们也要负责去设计，然后真的实施社会投资的计划，然后他们也要能够如果有需要补偿的话，他们要把这个机制给建立好。然后他们如果当地的居民有要去回馈或者要抱怨一些事情的话，他们也要把这个机制建立出来。另外，他们也要负责去跟当地的居民协商，然后签署所谓的影响跟好处的协议。那这个协议就是像一个合约一样。然后他们也要去发展社会影响管理计划。他们如果有相关的政府单位或者是一些当权团体，他们如果需要一些文件，也是要透过社会影响评估来准备。另外，他们也要去管理这个计划案它下面的很多的承包商跟当地居民之间的关系，因为一些比较大的开发计划案，你可以看到它下面是有很多的承包商的。那对于当地居民来说，很多时候对他们带来影响的不是最主要的开发商，而是下面的承包商，这个也要纳入考量。另外，他们也要准备一些文件，是要提供给刚刚提到的一些金融机构。那么，另外他们也可能要进行一些尽职调查，然后去评估他们有没有真的合乎一些非政府组织的标准。然后最后，在一个计划要结束之前，他们也是要提前计划。那社会影响评估也要在这一方面进行辅助。
So I think we say that there are 26 tasks that social impact assessment has to do, and they can be represented in a diagram like this with four main headings. Basically, it's about understanding the issues, it's about predicting and assessing the likely impacts, it's about developing strategies to deal with the impacts, and it's about having a monitoring programs.
所以刚刚一共列出了26种不同的任务是要由 SIA 就是社会影响评估来负责的。那我们如果大略的去区分的话，又可以再把它归分成四类。这四列分别就是：第一个，你要去了解议题是什么；第二个，你要去预测然后评估有可能的影响；第三，你要去发展出一些策略；然后最后，你还要有一些计划可以去真的监测或者是去控管这些影响。
So social impact assessment leads to better outcomes.By working with the regulatory agency, by working with the proponent, and by working with communities, better outcomes for all stakeholders can be achieved.
所以透过社会影响评估，我们可以带来更好的结果。它就是在协调于政府、企业还有当地的居民之间，然后让大家一起都可以得到更好的结果。
Basically, communities have more say in decisions. They become revitalized.Social capital can be built, the harmful impacts can be avoided, and project benefits can be maximized. For the private sector, they have better relationships with their local communities, with their workforces, and other stakeholders. They're much more likely to have a social license to operate. They will avoid costly mistakes. They will avoid risk of future compensation claims. They will avoid risks of court action or litigation.And they'll have better siting decisions because they'll be able to utilize local knowledge in the way they plan for the project. The government will be better off by having better information on which to make decisions, and financial institutions will know whether or not projects are risky projects from the point of view of lending money.
所以如果我们再把它带来的好处分成不同的面向来看的话，它对于社群或当地居民的好处是在于说，他们对于整个过程开发的过程当中可以有更多的发声权，他们可以去影响它的结果。然后另外他们也可以建造他们的社会资本，去降低这个计划带来的负面影响，然后把它的好处可以最大化。对于 企业也就是开发商来说，当然他们就可以改善跟当地居民之间的关系，改善他们跟工人之间的关系，然后跟他们所有关系人之间的关系，他们可以得到社会许可去营运，然后可以避免一些真的非常需要花钱的错误，然后也可以避免以后他们可能还要再提供一些补偿。那么他们之后在选新的地址的时候也会有更好的资讯，因为他们等于是受到了当地居民的一些反馈。那么对于政府机构来说，他们也可以得到更好的资讯来帮助他们做决定。那最后对于金融机构来说，他们也可以确保他们投资的这个计划案不会赔钱。
So what this means is that there's a strong business case. Social impact assessment is not a cost to business. It doesn't even delay, if properly planned, it does not even delay projects. Social impact assessment is, there is a strong business case because it will assist the project in identifying the risks and managing the risks. It will assist the project in getting access to land and resources. It will improve their access to the local workforce.It will mean that all the issues that are likely to happen will be identified early on. That means that the costs associated with managing issues will be much less. In economics or business planning, there's a concept called full cost consideration. You don't want to make a decision about project approval without understanding the full costs.So good social impact assessment means that you're in a much better situation of having full cost consideration. All of this means that there's greater certainty for investors, there's greater certainty for government and for society. This means the project will get a social and legal license to operate, it will have better stakeholder relations, there'll be better reputation, and this will increase the long-term success of the project.
Please.社会影响评估其实在商业上来讲也是一个很好的做法，很多人可能会误以为说社会影响评估会让成本增加，然后可能会让一些计划开发的这个时程被延宕到，但其实并不是这样，反而呢我们可以看到，如果你有做好的话，如果社会影响评估有做好的话，它不仅是可以有效的去指出风险在哪里，然后去加以管理，它可以帮助企业去取得更多的土地跟资源，然后让它可以去取得当地的居民的他们的工人，然后也可以帮你很早就指认出可能发生的问题在哪里，进而去减低你的成本。在商业上有一个所谓的全面的成本考量，也就是说你在开发一个计划案之前，你要把所有可能会发生的成本会花到的钱都纳入考量。那有了社会风险或者社会影响的评估之后，就可以帮助企业去更加的更好的理解到他们全部会开支出的成本有哪一些，也就是说对于投资人来说，对于政府来说，还有对于整体的社会来说，他们的确定性都增加了，也帮助这些企业可以去取得不论是法律上还是社会上的许可，让他们可以营运，让他们去改善跟所有关系人之间的关系，可以改善或者是维持这个公司的名声，那么长期来说也可以确保他们的成功，然后避免一些风险。
So to express this in business management terms, this is the model that's called the drivers of business. Basically business management says that all businesses face the same business drivers, and the point of the last slide isAll of those key, all of these business case, the strong business case for social impact assessment means that all business drivers will be enhanced. There'll be revenue growth, there'll be cost savings, there'll be improved access to capital, there'll be better risk management, there'll be better human capital, and there'll be better reputation. All drivers are enhanced.
所以在企业管理的方面，我们常常会讲到有一些驱动因素，那如果我们把社会影响评估做好的话，对于这主要的六大驱动因素都是有正面的效果的，所以对于公司不论是它的营收的增加、成本的降低，或者让他们可以取得更多的资金，然后风险管理还有人资的部分，另外还有他们的名声的部分，都是可以受到加分的效果。
Now I'm conscious of the time. this is a good stopping point. I did actually have some more, and if you would like, I could continue, but if you prefer that I stop now, then this is also a good time. So may I get an opinion?
好，对，因为时间的因素，所以可能这里作为一个停顿点是可以的。但他后面还有准备更多的东西可以讲，那所以他这边想要问问看大家，希望他继续讲下去呢，还是就停在这边？
I'm very curious
that
what is about.The topics, what is going to be mentioned.
So what's coming next, new concepts and trends?
Okay.
All right, so who's the decision maker here?
好，所以这边由谁做决定呢？
Will I carry on or stop?
要继续还是就在这边停下来？因为接下来会提到的一些新的概念跟可能的趋势。
In your opinion, you think that the SI should involve the EI or EI involve the SI, or they should independent, just compromise or collaborate? What's your opinion?
Okay, that's a very good question. Because they need to work together, but they don't need to be the same.
Yes.
I've been arguing that social impacts need to be managed right from the beginning. Right? So EIA does not happen right at the beginning. Social impacts must be. However, a report to the regulator could be at the same time as the EIA. And many social impacts come from environmental impacts. So we need to know what the environmental impact assessment people come up with in order to fully understand all of the social impacts as well. So they need to be aware of each other and they need to interact, but they don't need to be exactly the same process.
所以刚刚的问题是问到说，不知道教授的看法对于 EIA 就是环境影响评估跟社会影响评估，他们之间是要融合呢，还是要分开？那教授的看法是，这两个评估，确实是有很多相似之处，可是他们可以紧密的密切合作，但不需要合为一体，因为刚刚一开始有提到，环境的影响是从动土之后才开始，可是社会影响是在那之前就有的，所以在计划一开始在这个开发一开始还在计划的时候，就已经可以先有社会影响评估。那实际动土之后呢，社会影响评估还是需要跟环境影响一起合作，因为很多时候社会影响是来自环境影响，所以社会影响评估的人要去问环境影响评估的人说，你们做出来的结果是什么，然后他们再把一起他们的发现或者是他们的报告一起去传递给政府组织或者是管理的单位。
I think that, first of all, we actually, many things that Professor Lucas gave us very wonderful framework of SIA. Okay, so let me give him the big hand, okay? First time, and the attention. Now we open to the floor, I think that we can exchange more the different opinion from the individual experience of the, from the different performance difficulty that we can explore more opinion, more framework. So, first of all, 我们先收集几个问题啊，不要一个一个回答，因为这样多。然后我们就是先有三四个问题，那就请大家每个问题大概就是两分钟，好不好？然后报一下你的单位，我让他了解一下。好，然后我们大概收集三四个问题，让他第一环回答，再当第二个问题。那如果同仁需要有比较多的时间，我们可以在第二问题再给大家。那now we just open the to the floor. First of all, I will collect the two or three questions, and that Professor Venus can respond, and then we can go to the second round of the Q&A. Okay. 那我们就先收集问题，看大家。
都可以
用一下麦克
风。就是说，我想问问，就是在演讲中有提到，我们会 correct information 跟misinformation， 但问题是这样的前提是不是假设我们有一个标准去区分它们？就是在现实中我们可以看得出，就是一个开发案它相关的事实本身对不同团体来讲，它就完全不一样的看法。在这个样子的情况之下，你应该要 就是你对于什么才是正确的事实你都没有共识的话，你要怎么样能够去管理很多资讯流通啊，然后不要让谣言误传啊什么之类，因为对某一方来讲这是谣言，那对另一方来讲这其实是事实，不是谣言，是你才是谣言。那在这样的情况之下，我们要如何处理这个问题？
Okay, so the first question is that in your talk, you talked about how we have to manage the spread of information and misinformation. However, how do we define what is misinformation? Because in different groups, maybe they will view the set of facts differently. Maybe something that group A considers as true information will be considered as misinformation to group B. So,in order to manage misinformation, of course, we have to first define it, but the question is, how do we define it?
Okay, we collected some more questions. 有没有？
大家好，教授好，我是台湾实习张淑珍。那很谢谢教授很精辟的演讲啊、哦。那我这边提出来的，不好意思哈、哦，就是我这边有两个问题哦，就是比较实务上的一个问题哦。其实我早上听过来的一个了解就是。社会影响评估呢，它其实最重要的就是在沟通、资讯的正确和公开，以及关怀，还有一个最后我今天很难得听到一个同理心的一个作为哦。那同理心的作为，如果是在师部门的话，应该是可以做得很好，譬如说像补偿啊，或者说考虑到它种种像披萨店的一些观念哦。但是在公部门，公部门的话就很难用法律来突破这一块。那可能要请教教授，就是就他的经验来看，在公部门的开发案的时候，在同理心的作为的时候，是不是有一些比较好的一个做法，或者是突破法律规范的一个做法？那另外一个教授提到，就是评估的一个结果要为当地居民所接受。我现在就必须想要请教教授的地方，就是说所谓的当地居民的范围。
Okay, so two questions. The first is that, again, thank you for your talk. And based on your talk, we can know that SIA involves a lot of communication and a lot of transparency. But another thing that people often neglect that was mentioned in your talk is that people should have empathy and we should compensate those who are affected.Now, the question is, for private sector, for private developers, maybe it is easier for them to empathize and to compensate those who are affected. But when it comes to the public sector, when it comes to government, if the developer is a government agency, then they are really bogged down by a lot of regulations and legal issues. Now, how can they get rid of or overcome these legal restrictions to provide adequate compensation for those who are affected? And the second question is that you talked about the aim of SIA is to get local acceptance of different projects. Now, the question is, how do we define the scope of local people? Who should be considered local people?
The question about misinformation, what is it? It's a very good question. And the way the question was explained to me revealed the complexity of that question. Actually, there's no simple answer because exactly like the question was asked, what is misinformation to one person is potentially information to another. In fact, this is a whole problem for all of environmental impact assessment.Because the facts are always contested for every project. Science sometimes naively attempts to say we scientists, we know the facts, but always community groups will challenge scientists, and quite often scientists are revealed to be either in error or taking a one-sided view. In fact, when you start acknowledging the existence of Indigenous peoples, one of the important things about acknowledging Indigenous peoples is the awareness that they have different cosmologies, that they have different epistemologies, that the way that they understand the world works is different. And it's important in terms of respecting local communities and respecting Indigenous peoples, that acceptance of multiple ways of thinking about the world and how it works are important and have to be incorporated into science. So I think it's a rhetorical question.
好，所以第一个问题提到说错误资讯的这个问题，其实问题的发问方式就可以听得出来，这是一个非常非常复杂的议题，所以我们没有办法给他一个很简单的答案。那现在常常见到的问题就是，我们光是在做环境评估的时候，可能科学家他们提出的一些数据或者是事实，最后都会被人家质疑，因为科学家他们常常会很天真的认为说，啊，事实就是事实啊，不就是这样吗？可是对于当地的居民来说，他们可能就会去挑你里面是不是有错误，或者是觉得你可能没有那么客观，所以最后，就算是有些人觉得是事实的，还是对于其他人来说会被质疑或者会被挑战。那尤其是现在我们知道有一些开发案可能会牵扯到一些所谓的原住民，那原住民他们对于世界观或他们的宇宙观可能跟其他的人又不太一样，所以我们能够做到的就是尽量去包容然后尊重不同的观点，然后想办法把这些观点纳入在我们的评估当中。但是除此之外，这个问题其实也没有一个真正的答案。
So on the second question about the public sector versus the private sector, and the public sector being constrained in what it can do, that view is the case the world over. So actually, around the world, people are probably better off being affected by private sector projects than public sector projects. If you think about it, that's a terrible outcome. So,there needs to be improvement in the way that the public sector does projects. And one of the avenues to promote this is the human rights lens applied. Because a human rights lens is starting to change what is regarded as acceptable outcomes. Any project that results in a reduction in the well-being of people is not consistent with a human rights perspective. So,the human rights, because there are always hidden costs in every project to people, there are hidden impacts, and if people are being resettled, there's especially lots of hidden impacts. The view from a human rights perspective is that people must be made better off. So we need to change the paradigm, we need to change the perspective to having a more positive view and to viewing affected peoples as partners in development who are to be improved through the development process.
好，那回答下一个问题，提到公部门跟私部门之间的差异，其实这个问题问的也是非常的好，因为我们在世界各地都可以看到相同的情况，甚至有些人会觉得说，我宁愿被企业影响，也不要被政府影响，那这其实是很糟糕的一个结果。那我们能够做的要怎么样改善这一点呢？就是只能够透过在评估的时候，希望政府他在做影响评估的时候，可以透过一个人权的角度去思考。所以所谓的人权，当然就是如果你今天这个开发案会影响到一个人他的福祉，只要是有任何的负面的影响，这样就是影响到他的人权。所以我们知道开发计划案背后是有很多潜在的影响、潜在的危险或是潜在的成本。那举例来说，如果今天你要移居一些居民的时候，他对这个人来说就是影响到他的人权，所以我们只能够提醒政府说，你在做一个开发计划案的时候，你是希望可以让大家的情况都改善，而不是要去负面的影响到任何的一些人。那能够做到的就是这一点。
The third question about the definition of local people, or who is the affected people? Now this is a very critical question, and it's also problematic. Sometimes regulators want an easy solution, and sometimes, you know, with an engineering mentality, there's the notion that there are contour maps, contour lines on a map that can be drawn. So there is often a view, it's just a simple matter of a simple radius from the point of impact, and that defines affected people. Unfortunately, in social world, it does not work like that. The social area of impact can be very different than the physical zone of impact. And in fact, in social impact assessment, we tend not to even think about a concept called the impact zone. People can be impacted in different ways. People close to a project can be positively affected or negatively affected, and people far away from a project can be positively affected or negatively affected. In fact, transport routes, you know, projects are very complex and have all sorts of flows, including transport, including where people come from, what people do, how things happen, even the way pollution, noise, and so on are dispersed. It's not so easy to have a simple solution to saying this is the impact zone. In my view, there should be an avoidance of a geographical line on a map to define who is impacted, and there should be a much more fuzzy or fluid notion of people who come forward as claiming that they are being impacted.
问题讲到说当地居民或者是被影响的居民要怎么定义这个问题也是非常的重要，可是这个问题也非常的复杂，因为对于法规单位或者政府来说，他们当然是希望可以有一个很简单的解决方案，我就把地图拿出来画几条线，或者是规定说哦，距离这个开发案它的方圆几公里或多少之内是被影响的人那这可能是一个简单的解决方案，但在现实社会的世界当中却不是如此。我们可以看到一个计划案它带来的实体的影响跟它带来的社会影响是完全被切割，是完全不一样的。所以我们在做社会影响评估的时候，就是要想办法去避免定义出一个所谓的影响区域，因为真的一个计划案它带来的影响可能对于离这个计划案近的人而言会有这一种影响，对于远的人来说又有另外一种影响。那另外有一些计划案它可能是跟交通有关，或者它可能会带来一些噪音或者一些污染，所以我们没有办法用一个单一的解决方案去看它。那能够做的就是尽量去避免在定义上的时候把一个地理位置给定义出来，然后说这个位置里面的人是被影响的人。他教授的看法是我们在定义的时候需要一个比较模糊然后是比较流动性的定义来定义说被影响的人是谁。
我有两个问题请教。第一个问题是说，就是在执行社会冲击评估的时候，以国外的经验来说，是由哪一种单位来执行，会让整个计划的过程会比较顺畅？比如说，以台湾是在执行个案环评的时候，是以大部分是以顾问公司在操作。那如果是在执行政策环评的时候，可能是由政府单位或者学术单位。那因为每个单位的立场不同，然后它的拿到的写的或者是成本时间也都不同，所以大家的因为立场不同，所以做出来的效果都会差很大的。所以那如果在执行社会冲击评估来说，是以比如说独立单位比较好，还是说以学术单位比较好？就是想请教授分享一下。那第二个问题是说，假设今天在这个计划它是属于全国性的，比如说全国性的能源政策好了，那它的 stakeholder 可能就是全国人民都会受到影响。那这样我们在选择你要沟通的人的时候，你要怎么去选择？比如说，是不是可以选择不同声音的 NGO 来沟通就好？还是说，我们根本是要做一个全国性的，比如说，抽样抽民众，大家来开会沟通这样子？那以上两个问题，谢谢。
Okay, so two questions. The first question is that based on your experience or experience in other countries.When they are conducting SIAs, what kind of units or organizations are in charge of conducting SIA? Take Taiwan, for example. When we are doing EIA, it's usually consultancies who are doing that. And we're assessing the impact of policies. It's usually the government or academia that's doing that. However, given that each organization might get their funding from different sources, they might be given different amounts of time to carry out the assessment, their perspective or the results that they reach might be different. So when we're doing SIA, how do we decide which organization or which unit gets to do that? Are they supposed to be independent? Are they supposed to have an academic background? What's your view on that? And the second question is that you talked about different projects might affect different people. But say, for example, if today we're doing a project that is going to affect everyone in the nation. For example, if it's a energy policy that's being stipulated, it's going to affect every single person in the country. Now, when we have to communicate with them, how do we do that? How do we communicate with an entire nation of people at once? Do we just select specific NGOs and or specific groups and communicate with them? Or do we sample different people, each and every citizen in the country, and through a random sampling, select different people to attend a meeting or a hearing and communicate with them?
Okay, now we will have two Professor Xu Yongchong 教授 and Xu Shilong 教授Let's the question. But before that question, I will bother to follow this question. Because when we actually conduct the draft of SIA regulation, some consultant companies tell us when we not clearly define what is the scope of the impact area or the, who will be the scope of this impact area stakeholder, they will actually very difficult to perform this kind of new work for them. Okay, so this is my question. Okay, Xu Zhong from us.
Thank you. This is Richard from the University of Taipei. I have a question about scale. Yeah. So as you said, most of the sample of SIA will deal with the small scale. For example, it's community, street, or small group, or so few people, or something. So how about the big scale? How do we decide to deal with the big scale? For government to want to build a free highway and build a big factory or something. Can you give me some case to talk about your opinion? Thank you.
Professor Xu Shilong.
Thank you very much for your excellent lecture. My question will be that I think this is, as you mentioned about the world about the paradigm, it seems the SIA is related with the paradigm shift about how can we make the public policy. In the society. In the old day, we always use a cost-benefit analysis to assess what kind of cost and what kind of benefit. And in Taiwan, we still use this kind of idea about a cost-benefit analysis. The other one idea is about a technological determinism. You also just mentioned about it. You know, a lot of the scientific experts, they always say that we own the knowledge about the science. So you are the lay person, you are the normal citizen. You probably don't own any PhD degrees, so you must listen to me. So we organize a very small member consist of the committee. The committee member always decide everything. So right now this is a big problem. I really enjoy your talk. And we have the, in our day, the public policy also decided from the top. The central government, the executive again, they decide the policy. Then later on, they make a decision in the first, initially. The decision has been made. But the assessment is later. So So the assessment always is a fact assessment. This is a problem in my country. So I really wish you can stay longer. I eventually talk with the premier of my country. We talk about the premier line. Yeah, we always say he's like a god, but right now I don't think he's really a god, because a lot of big project is on the way. A lot of project on the way, and also the project is really a big project. And a lot of people will be displacement, just imagine. Not only about the Aboriginal people, but also a lot of citizens in Taiwan. So, actually we have, you also mentioned about a due process of law. I mean the due process, we mentioned about process, the meaning is inclusion. Different ideas, different values, different people, also different information into the public arena. We can communicate, we can listen to each other, and we can debate. And the result of the consensus, probably we can define it as a public interest. So, my question is only one. If the government still strongly resists your idea, how can we do? Okay, that's the problem of my problem. We organized some NGO members, we walk on the street to demonstrate, but that will be tired, you know. And I also have rather weak. So if the government still stand on the old paradigm, how can we bring the government to the new paradigm that you have mentioned, your excellent nature at the last today? Thank you.
Well, these are very good questions. I think the question started with the units and organizations and who is to do social impact assessment. Well, the answer is it depends a little bit on how it's organized in a particular society. There's no one right way. In fact, there are many different models around the world, and the different models have their advantages and disadvantages. So the typical model around the world is a consultancy firm will do it. Sometimes it is an academic unit that would do it, but especially with the bigger projects, big impact assessments are big projects in their own right. Like environmental impact assessments, they take many person days of work, many hundreds of thousands of dollars of work, and sometimes actually millions of dollars of work in very big projects. So typically it's a large consultancy firm that does it. The question really isn't who does it. The question really is, how is the legitimacy of the impact assessment established? And that's an important question. How legitimacy of the impact assessment is established is in multiple ways. One is all the different stakeholders have to be satisfied. If the public is not satisfied, I mean, it's really important that the public is actively engaged in these processes and they hold the consultants to account. Because if the consultants won't do the right thing, if there's not public pressure. So the civil society action and NGO actions are really important here. The Environmental Jurists Association and Environmental Defenders Organizations and so on are really important in ensuring that things are done properly and to the standards that are required. It's also necessary that the professional associations of consultancies monitor what the consultancy firms do. If there's misconduct or corruption in a consultancy firm, then that needs to be dealt with within the professional association. It should be independent, and the question of, well, how can a consultancy be independent if they're being paid always arises. In general, consultancies argue that they would not get repeat business if they were not, if they did not stand by their integrity. So we rely a little bit on consultancy firms having integrity and doing it professionally, even though they're being paid by the developer. And with civil society pressure, maybe that does work.
好，第一个问题提到说，到底是要有什么样的单位或者是机构来执行社会影响评估？这个问题问得很好。那答案确实也是没有一个单一的简单的答案，没有一个正确答案可以提供给大家。现在在世界上有各个不同的做法，那不同的做法当然它都有它的利跟它的弊。那基本上最常见的做法就是跟台湾一样，透过一些顾问单位或者顾问公司或者是学术单位，那它也是一样会需要花掉很多的人力，花掉很多的时间，花掉很多的钱在做这样子的评估。那今天的重点其实不应该是放在谁去做评估，而是这个评估的单位它要怎么样去取得它所谓的合理性或者是合法性。那要取得合理性或合法性，你就是必须要让所有的关系人，尤其是社会大众，都可以对你的结果感到满意。那要感到满意的话，就是你必须要让他们可以积极主动的参与整个评估的过程。所以必须要有公民的投入，然后要有一些可能非政府组织或是公民社会或者一些环团他们的加入。那当然刚刚有提到说是由顾问公司在进行评估嘛，那可能也会请这个顾问公司他在受到其他的专业的协会或者是其他的顾问公司来一起监督他们。那刚刚另外一个问题是说，如果今天这个顾问公司他就是拿了开发商的钱，你要怎么样确定他是独立的呢？他可能拿了钱就是帮人家做事嘛，那确实这个问题很难去避免。那唯一可以给的回答或者是解释就是说，今天这个站在顾问公司的立场，如果他为了拿这个钱就去做他们想要的结果，那他就会损害到他自己的职业道德。那他的道德、他的名声被影响之后，以后他就不用想要再去接其他的案子了。所以我们能够做的就是尽量透过公民施压的方式，去确保说这一些顾问公司他们是真的有在维持他们的职业道德，然后他们不会去因为拿了人家的钱就拿人手短，然后就不好意思去说这个开发商怎么样。
On the question about when it's a project that affects the whole nation.How can we involve everybody when everybody is affected? That's also a very good question. And in fact, it happens, the fourth question was about big scale projects. So it's a sort of a similar question in a way. Basically, communication and engagement should not be regarded as singular or simple processes. They need to be multiple, diverse,and over a long period of time. So we need to treat engagement, participation, and communication much more thoroughly than has been done before. And with multiple forms of communication in different channels, that's how ideas about a project or a new policy or about a change in ideas can be spread. Now, who should be involved? Should it be a sample or not? There are different interests here. As part of doing a social impact assessment where you want to fully understand the issues, then yes, having a carefully selected sample is a good way to ensure that the social impact assessment team starts to understand all the different issues.However, some people have a greater need for engagement than others, and if they're not involved, they will not be happy. So in addition to having a sample which is used to, on the basis of social research principles, to understand what's happening, it's also important that those people who want to come forwardhave the ability to do that. If they don't, they will become disenfranchised and they will become then dissatisfied. So inevitably, the social impact assessment process is not for the project, but it has to interact with the project in the way the project communicates with affected communities and stakeholders.
那第二个问题问到说，如果今天一个计划或者政策会影响到全国的每一个人，那这个问题其实跟第四个问题很像，因为第四个问题也是提到大规模的计划，所以这一方面能够给的回答就是在沟通的时候，还有在跟民众互动的时候，不能够只有一个单一的做法，它必须要是透过不同的管道，而且是很多元的管道，而且时间轴要再拉长一点，而且要非常非常的彻底。所以透过不同的管道跟这些民众沟通，让他们了解到这个政策或者是这一个计划案对他们的影响是什么。那刚刚有提到说抽样的部分哦，确实不同的团体他们背后的利益或会被影响到的面向不同。那在做社会评估的时候，如果你有很仔细的去抽样，确实是对于你研究它的影响来说会比较有效。可是我们除了在真的研究跟了解它的影响之外，另外一部分也是要让民众可以满意嘛。所以对于某一些特定的团体或某一些人来说，他可能觉得他要参与的需求是比别人还要大的，他比较需要参与或比较想要参与。所以这种情况下，我们就也要抛开研究的这个考量，然后是让他们来参加这个讨论的过程，让他们觉得他们有参与到不然的话，他们可能就会不高兴，他们可能就会不满。所以我们要记得的是，社会影响评估有时候不是只是一个纯粹为了这个计划而生的过程，而是要让这个计划可以更有效的跟民众去互动。
So on the question about scope, how do we establish the scope? This is also a very important question. In fact, it's very complicated because if in a consultancy, there's usually a commercial contract between the agency that's commissioning the research and the consultancy firm that's doing it. And the terms of reference or the scope of the project has to be defined within the commercial contract in order to determine what the price of the exchange is, and also for the client to establish whether or not there's been a good delivery on what's expected. Now, the problem is this very classical way of thinking about a contract does not work in the social world. It does not work because we don't know what the issues will be until we start doing the research. So in social impact assessment, a new form of contracting is required that's called open contracting, and you negotiate the scope as the project proceeds, as the impact assessment process proceeds. Because scoping is usually the process by which the project, the impact assessment determines what the issues will be, right? It's not the scope of works. There's confusion in the terminology, actually. And the scoping of the impact assessment process, that process then determines, well, who are the people who are going to be affected? Are there indigenous peoples present? Are there lots of issues that are going to require lots of investigation, or actually is it not so problematic? So the final contracting cost gets determined after the scoping is completed. So you don't fix the price of the contract until the consultant's been appointed. So this challenges conventional contract managers because they're not used to this open way of contracting.
那另外一个问题问到这个规范或者是去指定范围的部分确实这是一个很复杂的议题，因为在商业上来说，这个开发商他们委托了一个顾问公司让他们去进行研究或者评估的时候，他们在合约里面可能就会写得非常非常明确。可是问题是我们没有办法用这种传统的或者是经典的做法来运用在我们的社会议题上，因为很多时候你的规范到底范围有多广，然后牵扯的社会议题有多少，都是要在你研究之后才会知道的。所以这种情况下，我们的解决办法就是让这个契约或者合约变成是开放式的契约，也就是说在这个评估的过程当中，双方都可以回去修改这个合约的内容，这样子我们才可以在过程当中看看是不是会影响到原住民这个背后牵扯的社会议题是很复杂还是很单纯，然后最后呢，这一个
合约它的成本或者它的价格是在全部这个评估都结束之后再来确定的，所以不是一开始就确定这个价格，然后也要颠覆我们传统的做法。
So the previous comment might be saying we need a paradigm shift in contracting. The last question was about paradigm shift in changing how the government thinks about things. And the question also made reference to the old-fashioned cost-benefit analysis. So yes, cost-benefit analysis was important decades ago, but over time it's proving to be not adequate because there's all these externalities. It's not just an economic assessment of costs and an economic assessment of benefits and seeing what the difference is. What social impact assessment adds is all the externalities that were not considered in the cost-benefit analysis. And the other problem is many of the externalities, they can't be quantified, especially not in dollar terms, part of the problem. And then the other problem is so many of the issues can be mitigated if good social management occurs. So social impact assessment should not be conceived as only being contributing to a decision about whether a project is proceeds or not. Social impact assessment should be a way of thinking about how to make projects better. And then I'll let you answer that and then I need to say a bit more.
Okay. 好，那所以刚刚第三个问题的回答，我们可以看到是在签约的时候，我们必须要有一个典范的转移。那下一个问题的回答就是，我们在政府的思维上也是需要一个典范的转移。因为刚刚教授有提到，很好，没有错，就是在过去几十年，可能往往都是透过所谓的 cost benefit analysis， 就是你去分析它的成本跟它带来的利益有哪些。那过去这几十年都这么做，可是我们渐渐就发现到这个做法其实并不合宜，因为很多时候我们在做社会影响评估的时候，它不像是一个经济影响评估一样有这么明显的好处，这么明显的成本，它是有很多外在的因素的。那这些外在因素很多时候又没有办法被量化，所以这就是一个很大的问题来源。那另外也要提醒的一点就是，我们在讲社会影响评估的时候，还是要记得我们不是只是做这个评估去决定一个计划该不该被进行，而是去决定说它被进行之后我们要怎么去改善它，所以它里面还是有很多管理的层面。我们在评估之后可能有一些议题或者有一些问题它会存在，可是你如果有好好的管理它就可以被改善，所以很多时候并不是这么简单的分析说利大于弊或利大于弊就可以了，所以重点是在管理而不是只是评估。
So, yes, I would like to stay longer too, and I think it's a beautiful country, and I wish that I have an opportunity to do so on another occasion. But I should also say the concern that you have about the situation here is not all that different anywhere else. So what we're presenting in our, in the document, the international guidance document,is what we hope is possible and what should be possible, but it's not the case yet that it's actually implemented like that anywhere. So this is a document that says it's an aspirational document and we want it to happen, and we make the case about the business case to encourage it to happen, right? But the situation that exists in Taiwan is not so different than in many other countries.Nowhere is social impact assessment properly implemented, but it should be, right? Now, how do we encourage governments to change to the new paradigm? Well, this is the discussion about everything, really, that always happens. I don't have any special knowledge on this, but we need to use all the mechanisms that are available in a democratic society.We need to lobby politicians, we need to engage with them, we need to interact with them. Maybe you can have university meets parliament days where you interact. When you should exercise your vote responsibly and carefully, you should, instead of just voting, you know, in the election cycle, you should interact in the political process, The social media has a big influence. The mainstream media has an influence. Political debate, public discussions all have an influence. So there are lots of ways in which we can influence and believe that paradigm shift is possible.
好，所以其实刚刚提到台湾的问题并不是台湾特有的问题，在世界各地我们也都可以看到类似的情况。刚刚教授在他的报告里面提到的这些规范准则其实是一个理想的情况，所以我们觉得这是可以做到也应该被做到，但不代表真的现在全世界都这么做，我们只是希望可以透过这个文件来鼓励大家这么做。所以并不是说只有台湾有这样的困境，因为现在在全世界各地都是一样，这个社会评估社会影响评估都没有真的好好的完整的被执行。所以到底我们该怎么样改变这个状况呢？当然教授他本人也不是这方面怎么改变政治的专家，那他能够提供的看法就是我们必须要透过民主社会现有的机制来想办法在体制内改变，所以可能透过去游说我们的政治人物，或者是去跟他们互动，去跟他们沟通，或者是大学学术机构可以举办所谓的国会日，然后另外呢，我们也要好好的去执行我们的公民投票权，投票的时候要理性，然后负责任的投票，那投完票也不是就没事了，我们还要持续的监督政府，这是一个持续的过程，所以我们要透过社群媒体，或者是主流媒体，或者是我们可以有一些政治上的辩论或者是讨论，透过这样子的方式来持续的监督，然后想办法改变我们政府的做事方式。
I think that due to the time, so we will gradually close this session. So in the afternoon, we have another session. Professor He will have some announcement. I think for the paradigm shift of governance, it's actually a big social engineering and social change. All of time in Taiwan, or in the essential as in the regional governance, it's the tends to the developments, which actually prefer to economic growth. I think this has also occurred all over the world. And Professor Xu actually is I think she's very deeply expect our new government to actually set a new thinking way and make it a new institution. But unfortunately, we don't see too much. Okay. And so, so this is the opportunity that we just opened the door and try to engage more institutions or engage more discussion. But actually, the problem for a long time is our policymakers believed the scientific boundary, the scientific baseline for making a decision, which also raised a lot of social history. Is there actually the reality that we face? So maybe it's a whole package that we might change. So our mission is that China still continue to exert pressure to our own government. I think that is what I want to say. So for this session, I actually thanks Professor Frank Mensik because different view and very vulnerable institutional frameworks. So thank you very much.